have to remain hungry.
There's huge potential within Europe. It's easy to envisage an order for, say, 10 tons of crab. The dream is bigger now than it was in the beginning. We dream bigger.
AIB, we're backing Brave. Featured customers received a gratuity. Allied Irish Banks PLC is regulated by the Central Bank of Ireland.
The Saturday panel on Off the Ball.
In association with AIR. Don't miss live and exclusive Premier League action this month on the AIR Sport Pack.
This is News Talk.
Irish League.
Yeah.
Welcome back to Off the Ball. Tommy Martin sitting in here in place of your regular crew of presenters. So do bear with us throughout the afternoon. We're doing the AIR Saturday panel now on the future of sport, and no less a topic. We're here with AIR, the home of AIR Sports. Get amazing live sporting content free with AIR Broadband. We do have Anthony Moyles, a former Meath midfielder, here with us. Good afternoon, Anthony.
How are you doing, Tommy? Good
Dan McDonnell, Irish Independent Football Correspondent, and Hugo MacNeill, former Ireland and Lions International, and now Managing Director of Ireland with Goldman Sachs. You're very welcome, gentlemen. Also, this kind of comes off the back. A few weeks ago, the Irish Times got a leaked copy of a report that the GAA, a group that they sort of mandated to go away and have a bit of a blue sky think. I'm sure you do it in corporate world all the time, you know, go off site for a couple of days and imagine the future. It was called Towards 2034, the 150th anniversary of the GAA. Now, it hasn't been published, it's not binding, it's not in any way, but this is what's going to happen. They obviously wanted to have have an idea at what the GAA might look like. And a couple of the things that they come up with is, things around integrating the women's game more in with the general GAA. One of the lines was the GAA will have a more more financially self-sustaining with a reduced reliance on external commercial interests and increased emphasis on providing enhanced playing and spectator facilities and services. And the one that got the most attention was that the GAA will have developed a model to recognise the time and effort contributed by senior inter-county players and their respective managers, which may involve a defined and agreed allowance. Does that mean professionalism, semi-professionalism? What does that actually mean? So it got us thinking about what the future of sport in Ireland would look like as a jumping off point. And we want you all to maybe factor in the big sort of themes and forces, technology and business and finances that will shape our sport as we go on. But firstly, Anthony, 2034, 2040, I don't know what age you'll be then. We'll put you on the spot.
I've got the calculator out.
What do you think the GAA will look like? Bearing in mind, I know you're also involved with the Club Player Association, and you've got a lot of concerns about where it's going. What will the GAA look like? What will the championships look like? And what will the lot of the general GAA player, both elite and grassroots, look like?
I could probably tell you what I would hope it would look like, Tommy. And I'm sure it'll be vastly different to what it will look like. I'd be kind of worried for, 2034 isn't that far away, actually, really, when you think about it. But, I obviously read different parts of the report. I definitely think there will be a shift, and there probably has already begun, which is the shift towards professional and semi-professional, or whatever way you want to call it.
Yeah.
I think the pressures that are being seen and that are being kind of laid on to inter-county teams and inter-county managers and the whole setup of inter-county panels is only going to increase. It's only going to increase as the kind of commercial aspect of the GAA increases, because with one you can't get rid of the other, I think. So, there's all these talk about, is he being paid under the table, isn't he not, and all these different things. But when you honestly sit back and think of the amount of time that inter-county managers are giving it now, it is pretty much a professional job. Most of the guys either have to take time out of their careers or they're in a career that allows them the flexibility to do it. But, from the time when I played and I finished, 5, 6, 7 years ago, it has ramped up again. And we hear this all the time, but it literally is. Like, I'm managing a club team, and even the time it takes on that, just at the club level of videos and video analysis and breaking it down and going to meet players and, outside of even the day-to-day running of the team, the training, the matches, going to see other teams, it's phenomenal. So they deserve, in my opinion, they deserve an allowance. Mm-hmm. And the allowance should be commensurate with, obviously, the time they're giving and where they go in the championship. And there's obviously ways you can work around this. Maybe there's a standard fee that is set or a standard allowance that's set. So that's the managers. Okay, you break that down and you go to the players. Do they deserve it as well? When one kind of ties in with the other. And yes, there's an awful lot of different variations and a lot of different problems that could be caused, you know, where Dan comes into the panel, but he's only on the panel for 2 or 3 months and then he's gone. Or, you know, I'm there for the last 12 years. Do I deserve more? All those different kind of things. And I don't know how exactly they did it, Hugo, at the start with the rugby. But I think there is probably, it is going to have to go to that. And I think as the game, especially if you see the Super 8, if that really takes hold, I'd be quite scared of what potentially could happen there. Because the Super 8, if you were to look at the Super 8 now and kind of forward it for the next kind of number of years, we'd all pick the 8 here, bar yeah. one or two. You'd have them all, you know, Dublin, Kerry, Mayo, Cork, Galway, whoever else. So you'd have probably 6 of the 8 nearly. And those guys probably eventually will say, after 4, 5, 6 years of Super 8, they'll say, listen, we're providing all of the revenue here, pretty much for the GAA. Mm. And they'll just put their hand up and say, what about us?
Mm.
You know, like, I mean, we're the only ones there. The rest, you know, the other 20-odd counties, does that really matter? They're gone out of the championship. They're not getting the crowds where we're providing absolutely everything. So there could come a really stressed point of time down the road if that's not managed correctly. And also that if there's not anything for the other teams to go for. So to forward on, I think there has to be tiers. There has to be competitions that, and I know some fellas will say, oh, I don't want to be in a B competition, but you can give incentives, you can give different things involved in that. You know, you get to play in Croke Park on our Ireland final day if you get into the last two, that you go into a higher level the year after, whatever it is. But it has to change, and I think the structure of it will have to change, and the whole province's thing between Leinster, Connacht, Ulster, that'll have to change. So there has to be some sacred cows will have to go.
Yeah.
If the game is to stay as vibrant as it is today and with as many kids as playing it today, because kids are smarter now than they've ever been and they've so much more stuff pulling at them than they've ever had. And, you know, the accessibility of rugby and soccer and tennis and this and this and this, it's everywhere now. Or just even the accessibility of sitting at home on videos. And they want to play regular games. They don't want to be told this or pulled or dragged or have nothing going on for the time. So I'd be worried about it. And, you know, it's. I think there's an awful lot of problems that could potentially happen, which hopefully don't happen.
Yeah, and obviously the job that's the Club Player Association and the responsibility of the GAA is to try and check what is, Hugo, and I want to get your take on this as somebody who's involved with an investment bank, so we may have an understanding of the drive that business and money has in sport. And you've obviously been following rugby since its inception, since the inception of the professional game. What Anthony is talking about, I guess, is elitism being driven by big teams generating big commercial income. Mm-hmm. That's calling for new TV deals, new structures where we want to see more of these games involving the big teams. And are those the same forces that have driven professional rugby so far and will drive them in the future in what is a changing time at the moment?
Yeah, I think so. And, you know, the GAA at the moment is fantastic. You know, I sort of grew up in Dublin, so I'm a Dub, and my mother-in-law is from Mayo, so we've sort of followed that dynamic over the last few years, and it's been, you know, phenomenal contests that are as big as in any sport, you know, rugby. So GAA is in a very good place. I think it's interesting looking as an outsider and is to be discussing these topics, because I think what rugby sort of found was that the pressure just kind of built up as this, you know, some teams were being fitter and fitter and fitter and training, you know, and had access to players who had more time, or there was some kind of benefits, and it just was, if you wanted to raise the standards, it sort of got to the stage where it had to be possible to, you know, accommodate everybody. And, you know, it sort of seems like in the GAA has often said that, you know, there may be players working in Dublin but have to sort of go and commute to go back and train with their teams. So if you want to try and make it sort of equal, you have to, I think, sort of be open. Now, I think the people in the GAA are absolutely rightly focused on preserving the ethic and all of the stuff that is great about the sort of the local, the community, the volunteer. But if you have one side or a couple of sides that are just going further and further ahead because they have more time to train, because they've got access to a bigger pool, if you don't try and equalise it somehow, you just find maybe that some teams are just kind of falling behind. And I think that's what was rugby. There was a lot of worry when there was a lot of forces when rugby went professionalism. And I played it just before the sort of professional era, and it was building up and up. And it was very hard to do both. It was very hard to play international rugby and actually sort of to work. Yeah. And it was kind of the pressure was building up. And so I think what rugby was very sensible is they kind of tried to relieve that pressure while trying to keep the sort of the ethos. And we were very lucky in Ireland that the kind of the provincial team, you know, so we went into the cups like the Heineken Cup and the leagues. Our teams, with the sort of the provinces that were in place in situ, Leinster, Munster, Ulster and Connacht, were absolutely able to sort of follow on in the professional structure, as opposed to in some of the other countries they had to artificially put regions together in Wales or in Scotland. So these topics are challenging and are relevant. I think the good news from rugby's point of view is as a model is that the game is so vibrant now, and the interest in it is so huge, and the standards are sort of so high. Because you know you just look at Leinster, you know two Irish clubs could have been in the final of the Champions Cup, and you look where the national team is. So I think the huge credit is due for the IRFU and Philip Brown, the CEO, and his team for managing that, kind of helping managing that change, keeping what was most important as regards the ethic, but also acknowledging the reality of what was kind of facing the players.
Well, what about where rugby is trying to go now with expansion, though, Hugo? That's obviously driven by potentially looking to increase financial revenues and grow the game and compete with, I think you touched on it, the English and French leagues. Mm. Is there a future in that? Is that reaching too far?
Well, I think this is the point. Having said out the sort of the great state of where rugby is at the moment, and having managed the change to professionalism, and particularly in Ireland with the sort of this year of the Grand Slam and the sort of the success of our clubs and potentially a European winner, Irish rugby is in great shape. But we can't sort of ignore some of the challenges that are coming down the line. And the biggest challenge, I think, is the disparity in money that the English and French clubs are getting through the TV rights. So for example, what do I mean? The Pro 12, I think the share, it shared 14 million euros. Now with the South African teams, they share about 18 million euros between all the teams in the league. The English Aviva Premiership TV rights share 53 million pounds. The French top 14 is somewhere in the 70s, going to 90. Why is that? It's because big, just like in soccer, big media companies, BT, Sky, who want to sell you and I, sort of the mobile phone, the landline, the Wi-Fi, and the content, have identified sport as a reason why someone will buy one TV station rather than the other. Now the problem is, what determines the amount that they pay? They pay the amount depending on the number of the population. So if you've got countries like England and France of 60 million plus, and you have the island of Ireland of 7 million, and then Scotland and Wales, is that the money is much less. So you're looking at the Pro 12, and that difference in 1 year, you then compound it in 2 years or 3 years or 4 years, and so that even the average English or French clubs will have this huge reservoir. Now they've had problems at the moment. Some of them have overstretched to this date, and you've seen like big club like Saracens, where some of the owners are. So what's the lesson? You know, it's challenging in a sport like rugby, where it's not professional soccer. So less than 1% of rugby players, rugby players, will finish their career with financial independence. And it's very different to soccer. That's considerably less than 1% of players. They're all in a sport where one tackle can finish your career. So a lot of them will be faced with the kind of challenges that, you know, Pat Lam and others, you know, have faced. Now, the IRFU have done a fantastic job to date in keeping our players, but they'll come back. This will not be something we just have to deal with this year, but it's going to be the next year and the next year. And psychologically, you can see the difference. If a couple of your best players are taken out, you've even seen with Ulster having losing Leofano and a couple of other Pietau, psychologically, what does that do to you? And so, what does that going to mean? Is it means, I mean, the IRFU have been very good on the Pro 12, now the Pro 14. They've brought in, you know, two other teams, South Africans. That's tough because of the distance. At some stage, the United States, there's talk about that. But that's
realistic. Probably,
that's a way off, though, Tommy. That's a way off. So you kind of, if you have to sort of think of a scenario, and I've no idea if it's even been thought about. So how do you cope? How do you compete with that difference between the French and the English?
People have said join in with the English.
Well, see, that's just one of the things that's been talked about, because you have, can you get some access to that pool of the Sky and BT money to do that, to prevent your Gary Ringroses, your Jacob Stockdales, your James Ryan being picked off? Now, is there a case for that? Now, some of the English clubs would love the Irish teams. The Irish teams have won 6 European Cups. They've been beaten finalists in 3 others. No Scottish team has ever got to the final of the European Cup. No Welsh team has ever won it. They've only got 1 team to the final. No Italian team has even got out of the pool. So what you could see is a situation that actually the Irish clubs would look to try and get access to that English clubs. Now, there's big questions. Would they want all our teams? Would you have to have 2 leagues? If you're the lowest team in the English Aviva Premiership, you're not going to be wanting to this because you'll be relegated. But you know, the Irish bring huge crowds.
That's a force that could shape something in terms of structures.
And so it's again it's hypothetical, no idea if it could happen. But yeah. What really worries me is this TV money, wall of money, year after year, the clubs, they'll keep coming back after our players.
Sounds familiar, Dan, to the soccer world. You hear it with people saying, you know, at certain point in recent years, Celtic and Rangers joined the Premier League, or you know, would an All Ireland League work, or would a North Atlantic League of the smaller countries work? Put on your thinking cap taking those forces, and maybe from the position of League of Ireland clubs, for example, in the future, like, is it possible that League of Ireland clubs could play in a greater European league, or is the object to serve as a sort of a healthy, smaller feeder league for the big leagues?
Yeah, it's a strange. Like, it's interesting listening to the 2 lads in the various positions in the respective sports, because there's one huge similarity, and that's TV money and the power of TV money and how so many decisions in sport now are driven by that. And that is almost the bottom line. It's the main driver, and the fear that you would have, maybe it's a professional football, and maybe the slight contrast is how much of that those TV deals and that money is driven by overseas markets far, far away, like America and Asia, and the impact that that's having on, you know, sport in this part of the world, and more so in England. And like 30 years ago, you think, okay, where was football? There was like 8 teams in the European Championships. There was, you know, 24 in the World Cup. There was a European Cup. There wasn't a Champions League. So this has probably been as significant to 30 years maybe as there has been. But you're thinking, well, what is the next step? And it's interesting that people always presume that there's going to be some kind of, you know, breakaway Super League with super clubs. But I'm not so sure. Like, there was this recent FIFA in the last couple of weeks actually had Gianni Infantino spoking about how this mystery consortium has approached them and, you know, offered a huge amount of money to try and set up a new club World Cup, which would be, you know, with 12 European clubs and so on. But ultimately, what you have is something like the Champions League now that really works. It's hugely successful. The top clubs now, what they're doing is they're using their bargaining power with UEFA to get a bigger share of the pot TV-wise. For example, for like smaller leagues, for like in Ireland or even Scotland now, there is this route to the Champions League, this Champions route that Celtic have come through every year now. Like Ludo Goretz, Bade Borisov, when the Dundalk got one step away, that was their route. From next year, that's been reduced slowly but surely from 5 teams to 4. You can be sure in the next round of negotiations, you know, they're going to try and get it away. But they're not looking at a breakaway. It's like UEFA have a thing here. You know, it's generating huge money through the established TV deals. And yet at the same time, there's a governance there from UEFA, FIFA, that you still have to stay within it. I'm not sure if that breakaway that people talk about is feasible. To bring it back to the question about, say, Ireland, we're in a difficult situation because football is so established around Europe everywhere. I mean, here we're trying to catch up with leagues that have been professional for 100 years, but you go to places like Greece and Turkey and, you know, football is huge there, you know, passionate, huge crowds. Yet in the context of European football, they're nothing as well, compared to the top leagues. And so in a strange way, what they still have that really sells and works for them is their own domestic traditional rivalries, like the big clubs in Turkey, the big clubs in Greece, their version of Leinster v Munster or whatever it might be. Yeah. And this vision that people talk about some, you know, these cross-border leagues, I actually don't think they would be that hugely attractive to people, because you're basically talking about a long version of the Europa League. Like, the Champions League is where it's at. That's where everyone wants to be. Yeah. But below that, you know, okay, it's great. Celtic want to be, for example, it's a more viable option that Celtic are there. Celtic want to play Barcelona and Real Madrid. And do Celtic want to be in some Atlantic league where they're playing Malmo or, you know, with all due respect, you know, an Irish club, or that may not work as a model. So football has a different level of elitism.
Yeah.
That I think it's a problem. And how UEFA deal with this, by the way, is they get all this money from the Champions League, and politically for other factors, another huge factor as well. The money now that's going out for the lower European rounds that's been dished around Europe is huge. But it's creating like real problem in individual countries like Ireland, where like Cork and the Dock, for example, have been in Europe for the last 4 or 5 years. Because the entry level for getting into Europe money now is massive, like $250,000 minimum, then the other clubs in Ireland can't compete with them. So in every country around Europe, you're having almost a Super 8 version, or, you know, where you have these elite and the clubs that are behind. And TV money and the pressures of TV money has got the game in a bit of a bind, and I'm not sure how we get out of this cycle. You know, it's a really interesting time.
It's really interesting to hear and listen and watching football and sort of the power of money. And actually, up till recent, the power of the Leicester City phenomenon. Because up until Leicester City, the previous 10 teams had won the league. Well, only three of them had won it. One was Manchester City, Manchester United, and Chelsea. One was owned by a Russian oligarch. Another was by a Middle Eastern sheikh. Another, maybe the most successful sports marketing company in the world. You kind of then go back, even, so there was 10 of them. You go back 20 years, and you only added Arsenal. And you could probably argue that Arsenal had fallen out of it in the last 10 years. And, you know, I really remember growing up and seeing, you know, Everton, Liverpool, Nottingham Forest winning the thing. And so the question is now, has in the kind of, in a sense, normal service been resumed, because you've got Manchester City running away with the title? This could a Leicester ever happen again? Yeah. The Champions League is absolutely gripping, and I watched both semi-finals the other night, because it goes through to the end, whereas the Premier League, it's really over. It's been over for a while.
The logical follow-through from what you were talking about earlier, Hugo, is that we could be looking back on the days of Leinster and Munster winning Champions Cups as the Nottingham Forest and Aston Villa days, where, remember the days when an Irish team could actually compete in Europe?
Well, that is actually the really good question, because if the problem is, if the logic of that now, disparity in TV money. Now, it's not only the TV money. The Irish players are much better looked after, which is a very important point in kind of health. You look at a lot of the sort of the English players this year. I mean, I was told Maro Itoje, who came back from the Lions tour, played 45 games by the time that, you know, Ireland, he played Ireland in the Grand Slam game. And so there's more than money. But, you know, the numbers are so big is the thing that Irish teams have to plan. You know, the people who are running Munster and Leinster, and I know the RFU are thinking about it, is they're absolutely delighted how well things are going, but you have to sort of plan. And how do you compete with that wall of money? And you know, bringing in the South African teams and hoping one day that the US guys, that's going to be challenging. And so you may have to kind of think more radical things like an Anglo-Irish league, so that you get some access and you reduce that disparity, that you can protect your players.
And I think that's the main point, and as Dan says, is the financial, you know, wherewithal is the big thing, you know, and the resources that brings and everything else. So the preparation of teams, like if you follow, say, the line of that then, and say you look like a team in the GAA circles such as Dublin, or even Mayo for the fact, like the money that they have around them, okay, and the sponsorship deals, et cetera, just allows them have much more accessibility to resources, to different things, to training methods, to backroom staff, et cetera, to coaches and everything else. Say, oh, this is Dublin bashing. It isn't at all, but it's just a reality. That is it. So if you get a big sponsor, you then can say, okay, well, now I can, that it may not guarantee you're going to win in All-Ireland, absolutely not. But it will guarantee that you'll be as prepared as possibly you can be for that season. And then if you put it into the grassroots and everything else, well, then you should see the benefit coming true. But the money is the big thing. And when you come to a situation such as the Super 8 or, you know, even into the Premiership or whatever it is, it's how then you filter that down. So this thing of Man City running away with it isn't created, or the top four isn't, you know, and there's always been those times of dominant teams, in every sport, but you have to make sure that it's not, they're not completely, like they're not elite for 7, 8, 10 years in a row, and then the rest are just, you know, flitting around here at the bottom. There has to be something to go for, and that is maybe that you have to then be radical, that you have to, as I say, take away some sacred cows, and you have to say, listen, we have to create a system whereby, okay, the benefit may not be in a couple of years' time, but the benefit may be in 10 or 15 years' time. The GAA has a very difficult situation because of the population of counties and stuff like that. You know, Leitrim is never going to be contesting All-Ireland finals purely based on the actual playing pool. But could they be in a situation whereby, you know, you get them contesting for a second team or a second type competition? Absolutely, possibly. Is it a situation where in 10 or 15 years' time, because of the Super 8, that you'll find these smaller counties will actually merge together? Like the big thing about Ireland, you mentioned there, the rivalry. Like the rivalry even at club level is what people want to see. Like the club championship now is getting a massive amount of, like there's nearly more crowds going to club games than there are going to inter-county games.
So it's not necessarily about elites and, you know, everybody wants to see Real Madrid and Barcelona. You know, you can make compelling stories and sell them at any level, as long as you're talking about local rivalries.
Yeah, I'm interested in, like Anthony saying that there's always this, as you say, like the language, you know, everybody wants to see Real Madrid and Barcelona, and everybody wants to see Dublin, Mayo, whatever, and it's always the royal we when it comes to this. But I'm interested in the GAA example that, like, to me, the sort of phenomenon that is the GAA is just how people respond locally if their county is going well. And if you're talking about going forward to a model where, you know, if we're talking about a subscription channel or whatever it might be, like, over time, does everyone in Leitrim and does everyone in Fermanagh, do they just want to get their GAA sort of fixed through watching the big showdowns? Like, over a period of time, surely there's some kind of dream of being involved in it themselves. And is that market really deep enough if you don't have access to it at all? I know, as in sports media or people at the high end want to see the best games, but is that what's made it work over a period of time? To think that this is going to be a seller, that's something that's really going to work. I mean, that's the challenge. I don't know. We've never been there.
That is the question. You mentioned Leitrim. I remember playing for Leitrim many years ago, but it was in New York. it was a guy who got a job as a guy called Mike Carty around the Rosie O'Grady's chain, and he had Colm O'Rourke and some of the GAA guys, big stars out there. And I dropped by and I got a couple of games for them. So I always sort of have a fond spot for
what could have been.
But it is tough. But there has to be also the dream. I think what was. And the question is a Leicester, was that Leicester City, was that a one-off? Could that ever happen again? Or was it just when the big teams were actually in a sort of rebuilding phase? Or because it just captured people's imagination, but is that just a kind of a one-off and normal service?
Well, it was romance of a Premier League type. Yeah. It was still an Asian owner coming in and pumping a lot of money into it. Like, it's sort of it's not quite Brian Clough's Forest. No, you know what I mean?
Exactly.
In terms of
it's interesting. I was reading up about the whole idea of the technological side and how sport might look different. And there was a story, The Guardian did a series of features on this, and they followed this this YouTube phenomenon called #United. Which was basically this guy, I think he was a failed stand-up comic, and he set up a team of his mates, and he films their games. They play against other non-professional teams, but they film their games. They play in sort of reasonably good non-league stadiums. They cut them down into little YouTube packages. He speaks to he goes, you know, it's that sort of YouTuber level of conversation where you go, hey guys, today we're playing the team from the Royal Mail or whatever, and they have a game, and it becomes an ongoing story, and it's become this this YouTube sensation, to use that that phrase, and it seems to me, because I want to move sort of into how technology and the way people are consuming sport will change in the future, that all bets are kind of off in this generation in terms of how sport is being consumed now. It's it's clips on Twitter, and it's streaming of games, and you talked about, you know, market for not everyone wants to watch Real Madrid Barcelona. Maybe you can watch your local club team on streaming. You know, so there's such a vast array of different possibilities. So just taking the GA, for example. So am I going to be watching every Donegal game on like a subscription season ticket pass?
You possibly will be. You know, but I think
GA TV will say.
I think Sky and RTÉ
will be gone.
You could have that. I think it goes down to the generation, and not to sound like an old fogey, but like the attention span is what the big thing is. Like, I mean, does anyone really want to sit through an hour and a half to 2 hours of a Premiership game, or, you know, whatever it is, 80-odd, 90 minutes of a rugby game? Most kids nowadays just want clips. They just want to see the action, shots on goal, whatever it is. So the attention span and the thing of that, I think, is a big thing. So that's driving all of that. So, you know, all the data and all the everything else, and the stuff that Sky are pumping out, as you say, it's all clips, it's all little small things, and it's making the accessibility of it. You can sit there on your phone, whether on the bus or on a train, and you can watch a local match, as you say, potentially. And absolutely, and I think even the use of the technology, and you're seeing this being driven then by teams, you know, the technological, like, I mean, they're talking about, you know, you have to have a strength and conditioning coach, but now the big thing is you actually have to have an IT expert. It's nearly as important. You have to have someone who can actually disseminate whatever information is there in now real time, and actually, instead of just analysing it after on a Monday or a Tuesday, they're advancing it in the States so much now that they're actually giving it as the game is going on. Mm. So you're hearing it, be it in the NFL, you're getting it actually in your helmet or whatever it is. There's all these Google glasses, there's all this stuff. Like, I mean, where it's going to go with the virtual world is unbelievable.
So you're envisaging a scenario where you've got all this data, and a coach is sitting, and the data is telling him that the left back is under pressure, that he needs to make changes. I mean, that can't be far away.
I mean, I think to a point. I mean, there's actually an Irish company, Stat Sports, that are you know, sort of serious now world player. Like, they're working with Brazil and a couple of teams for the World Cup this summer, and it's all about the GPS tracking systems on players. That is, like, I don't think teams are doing this now. They're figuring out how much running someone's doing during a game, who needs to be taken out of a training session at such and such a point because they're hitting, you know, this threshold or that threshold or whatever. I mean, that's definitely in place already, and it's only going to become a bigger thing, because particularly from a football perspective, a lot of the American investors and companies that are getting involved, and there's even one obviously that's taken over Dundalk now, but I know they're big into this, you know, the stats and the use of that and how that sort of drives it. So I think that is one thing. I mean, you talk about the virtual stuff, slightly off topic, but I mean, I was at an event in Tala a couple of weeks ago, the esports phenomenon, which sort of frankly terrifying to me, like, in a strange way.
Just, explain. Which is,
well, I mean, I'm struggling to, you asked me to explain it, because that would, the inference there would be that I understand it.
Well, people are saying it's literally tournaments involving people playing computer games
against each other, which is but it's, I mean, there's serious people involved with this, because they can, business people involved with this, because obviously they can see that it's going to make money. I mean, that's a practical thing. I was at an event where they're doing a roadshow around the country. They have like a commentary team commentating on them playing this game.
Yeah,
like
Legends
or something. Like that. Hey, listen,
I'm interested.
The future of broadcasting.
Where was that on?
Here to the Super Mario.
There's no Tuesday 7:45 restrictions here. You can do this at 4 a.m. if you want. You can broadcast to the Asian markets. But it is, I mean, slightly scary. But you can sort of scoff at it, but that is what, like, 15,
Madison,
16 people
Madison
are
Square
doing.
Garden.
Yeah,
Madison Square Garden filled out, absolutely filled out recently for exactly one of those things. It's fascinating. I think there's the kind of one of the things that there's been seen maybe with clips or on watching on your mobiles is there is so much sport now that you want to watch. There is so much sport, and what that enables you to do is to, you know, is to actually get access to it, whether it's Rory McIlroy and the Masters, and I want to watch the soccer, the Champions League, I want to watch Real Madrid, I want to watch Peter Leinster, and I want to watch, you know, Katie Taylor, or something. There's so much. So that's an efficient way of doing it. I think the other thing is that dealing with a lot of sport is that in my own sport, in rugby, the ball is actually only in play probably less than 50% of the time. And so some days when, if there's kind of three internationals or if there's a number of European Cup games, just kind of try and record them and then actually fast forward. I fast forwarded through a game and watched all the action recently, and it was 35 minutes when the ball was in play, because it was not the scrum being reset and formed out.
Yeah.
So it's That's actually helpful. But I think the good thing is for the really big games, you know, for an All-Ireland, for the big game, the All-Ireland finals, the Grand Slam games, the games that people, there's nothing that beats actually watching the whole thing.
Yeah. And I wonder, I mean, we talk about the availability of different options, something for, you know, for the League of Ireland to bear in mind. Okay, you're going to have, I guess, the marquee events, the massive events, but there's so much opportunity to market yourself, you know, in terms of, as Anthony was saying, the clips, getting it out there, getting the stories, creative, like I was talking about. Yeah. And I wonder, is that the big you know, because, I mean, obviously the ongoing discussion about League of Ireland is how to market it better and how to, you know, to sort of to create a sort of a brand that's relevant to the upcoming generations. I mean, you have a situation now where you can't see clips of goals scored on a Friday night until after the highlights program was out.
72 hours later, which is Stone Age stuff, and people have come into it from outside again can't get their head around this now. And I mean, or in fairness, RTE have tried to address it if something amazing happens by putting it out on the Saturday. But yeah, I think, like, you know, for smaller leagues or smaller brands, you know, definitely the way in which you can use social media is huge.
Why is that, Dan? Why are they doing that 72 hours?
Because it's part of the deal that was signed a period of time ago. Now, I think it's up next year, and I think, to be fair, I think they've acknowledged that they need to go on forward to be more creative. Because I think, I mean, you know, the Hugo scenario you speak about there, about people fast forwarding through games and so on, this is the real fear for the big TV companies paying the big deals. Yeah. Yeah. People aren't then listening, they're fast forwarding through the ads.
Absolutely.
Which is going to obviously impact the value of the deals. Yeah. But back to the point for the smaller leagues, because it's funny, I think it's sort of unhealthy in a strange way that. Now, like, if someone's an Arsenal fan now, you know, they can watch Arsenal Fan TV, they can get all their media from ArsenalFC.com. Mm-hmm. You know, they're in this echo chamber where everything they consume is there, whereas years ago, you almost had to sit through everyone's game on Match of the Day, or you'd watch every sport, because there was so little sport on TV that, you know, you'd watch the rugby at some times of the year, you'd watch Wimbledon, you'd watch the snooker, because that's all that you had. Whereas now, people can be very singular in terms of where they get their content and where they go. So for the League of Ireland clubs now, they have to be, when they are servicing a small enough market, they need to get the message out there to them, because they're not always getting the general audience that you might have years ago.
So have a loyal
and develop it. And then, like, some people are doing it very, very well. Again, I mean, you know, I sort of, down in Cork City last night, you know, 6,500 people at the game, and locally they're doing a lot of good stuff, and their social media, I think, is quite good, and you have to do it, and you can't be subject to a dated TV deal from an old way of doing business that, you know, word of mouth is how things travel, you know. So did you hear about that amazing goal last night? And you have a 1 hour, 2 hour window, or into the following morning where it's live, and then come Monday evening at 7 o'clock or 11 o'clock, this happened on Friday, when in the meantime, the whole weekend, people have watched all the Premier League, all the Liga, all everything else, by the time you get round to it. I mean, I think that's going to be addressed. I think going forward again, you know, the streaming of games on, you know, Facebook and Twitter and, you know, Amazon, all the various angles are being explored. And I think it's going to happen in other, you know, in other leagues. And, you know, they could well be the players in the TV deals of the future that aren't there at the moment. But certainly, you know, for the smaller clubs, I mean, they have to use that. And I mean, they would always say it's free, actually. You know, it's a free way of doing business.
Famously,
you know?
the commissioner of the NBA a few years ago, people asked him, "Oh, are you annoyed at everybody uploading, you know, illegally uploading clips of great baskets and scores in basketball onto YouTube?" And he said, "No, it's free marketing."
Absolutely. But it's the funny thing, the technology and the, you know, the virtual stuff that's coming on board. Like, when you think of, you know, 20, 30 years ago where we were, and you think of 20, 30 years ahead, which is, I suppose, kind of what we're touching on as well, it's quite scary what we could be potentially looking at. You know, you talk about even this, you know, e-sports thing. You know, I was reading a piece there, there was a TED talk there done, and they were talking about the potential of, you know, that some games are so brutal, say the NFL, you know, so where guys are just getting broken down continuously. And it's unbelievable. I'm in a fantasy league, actually, with some of the boys from here, and you have a fan, you get your team at the start of the year, and the amount of fellas who, by the end of the year, who are gone, you know, gone through to, like, I mean, it's when you just actually follow a team and you follow some specific names, you really see the attrition level. Mm-hmm. It's unbelievable, just going, you know, knees blown out, never to play again. And they're saying that potentially, you know, with AI and with robots and everything else, that you could get sports that are actually just performed by robots or synthetic kind of being.
Virtual reality.
And we're actually just sitting there watching this.
One of the really exciting things for sort of my own sport, rugby, is that it's still, in world terms, still a pretty small sport. I mean, even I played the first World Cup in 87. This is the teams that I'm playing then are the sort of the teams now. And I think there's great potential with the next World Cup going to Japan and actually being spread out, the whole potential of the United States, which I know was part of a World Cup bid, was a big sort of focus, and just seeing this sort of explosive way that the game is growing. So that even as, you know, I think there's very, and the sevens game is a sort of a very interesting way of sort of getting, you know, people to watch rugby at first who weren't familiar. So, and it's now become part of the Olympic Games. So I think as well, sort of the challenges that kind of sports are sort of facing, there's also, you know, enormous opportunities. And we certainly sort of see it in the rugby world, the potential of broadening this sport from a relatively small number of countries that are playing it into a much wider is huge.
You look at, say, GAA, for example. Like GAA, like hurling, they reckon is a potential sport that people really, you know what I mean? The Americans have actually really got into it. And there's loads and loads of actually just American kids. You know, it's not the expat stuff. Like, I mean, the American kids have actually taken it up and they're playing it in.
Well, it's a really good point, because one of the things that the GAA were phenomenal in our World Cup bid, I remember being in with Porrick Duffy and he just showing me through the GAA international annual report. And if you haven't seen it, it's just phenomenal to see exactly that you're saying. Rate of growth that there is, and like was the Middle East was coming up, and Galicia in northwestern Spain has had been growing the numbers, in additional to the sort of the traditional heartlands where it had grown, like London and the US.
So, backed by a Chinese billionaire, the Shanghai Gaelic, with the All Ireland hurling tag in 2044.
But surely, like the
coached by a full time.
Or Jim McInnes would be involved. But the Ireland New Zealand game in Chicago.
Yeah.
And there's another game this October, isn't there? Ireland Italy maybe are playing in America. That surely this is. But is this the model going forward, that all of a sudden you start getting events and games being brought to America? Because, like, I think in football world now as well, like the MLS is growing, they're putting a huge amount of money into it, but there comes a point where they can't just be having exhibitions all the time. Right. They want stuff of significance.
That's a really good point. But I think what is happening is the organic growth as well. And you know, it was interesting. I was in Chicago for the All Blacks game, and what was fascinating was seeing all the people who were coming from clubs around the US who are existing rugby clubs. This was a sort of a great focus and a boost. But the main thing, which addresses the point, the excellent point that you make, is speaking that night to some people who were involved in schools rugby in the United States. I just couldn't get over some of the numbers. And a lot of it was to do with the kind of injuries in American football and the sort of all the equipment and that you have to do.
Yeah.
Is that game is growing absolutely rapidly.
Can I just get onto this, because Shane will be cutting us off in a few moments. I really want to get this in, because one of the most transformative things in sport in recent years, certainly the last 5 to 10 years, has been women's sport and the growth in it, the increased popularity of it, and I wonder, will in 20 to 30 years time, okay, maybe not necessarily as big as, but will women's sport change the face of sport as we know it and how we consume it and how we understand it, or will it just be another competitor looking for eyeballs and attention, just like, you know, different rival sports?
I think it'd be a competitor. Like, I mean, I don't.
What's the scope for it?
Yeah, like, I mean, I have two daughters. I hope when they come of age and they're, you know, in their 20s, they're successful in whatever they do. And if it is some sort of sport or athletics or whatever it is, I'm absolutely delighted for it. But I don't think it necessarily has to be. It doesn't have to be taking from you know, anything that men do or anything like that. Like, I mean, they both can. Like, I mean, it's traditionally that, and I don't mean to, people are probably going to say that being sexist is different, but men looked at sport, you know, like, I mean, traditional times, and there was always this, like, I mean, most of the sport that was on TV was male-dominated stuff. I think the growth of a lot of, an awful lot of female sports is has really taken effect, and it goes back to the marketing point and the money point, that unfortunately, that's, you know, Premiership or the NFL or whatever it is where the big money is at, because that's where most eyes are on the prize. And until the point where women's sports gets to that point, you know, it's always going to be a little less so. But the growth of it and the playing of it is the beginning of
absolutely.
That.
Absolutely. And, you know, we've seen that in rugby, and it's been phenomenal through the sort of the World Cups. And, you know, the Irish women team, obviously, a little bit of difficulties at the World Cup and recently. But this has been a phenomenal kind of success. And I remember going to the sort of the finals and the semi-finals in Belfast. They were some of the best rugby games I saw last year, wasn't it? And it's really important. And I remember a couple of years ago, the Ireland team, we were sort of honoured at an Ireland's Fun event and Neil Briggs, the captain, was chatting away about their being in France when we beat the All Blacks and got to the semi-final of the World Cup, and we had to stop and take the microphone and say, the audience, you have heard an Irish captain say, you've heard no Irish rugby captain ever say that when we beat the All Blacks and got to the semi-final. But there's a really important point as well about this, Dominic, because the SRI did a study a few years ago about children dropping out of sports. It was at what stage did people stop playing sports, whether it was infant? And actually a big thing for young girls was in the teenage years, that a lot of them, although they played some of the traditional sports, hockey, netball or whatever, a lot of the girls were saying, this doesn't do it for me. And so there was a huge dropout. And so when you had a sport like rugby coming in, where you could not only just represent your country, you could be European or world champions, that was a sort of a really sort of powerful sort of message. And I think, you know, having seen the sort of potential of the women's rugby and seen it at its best, I think it's a huge potential, and it's absolutely in its own right.
If sport has been, you know, was created, as far as we understand it, by men for men, and that is changing, Dan, thankfully, at the moment. We work in an industry which has traditionally been dominated, male-dominated. Cast your mind forward, and how different could it look when it becomes more gender equal in the future?
Yeah, no, I think that, look, it's possible. I think I agree with Anthony. There's an element of, there's habit that comes with it, and spectating and going to games. Now, for example, the Irish Women's International recently against Holland was the biggest crowd I think they've ever had for a home match. Mm. But look, the significant aspect, and even I think the ladies' football final in Croke Park last year had the amazing attendance, was the demographic of the crowd. It was a lot of kids, a lot of young girls, you know, and that was the one thing noticeable in Tala that night was, and I suppose you're only going to change a culture if it's normalised almost at an early stage, that it's something that you do, that you go to games, it's habitual, that if you grow up going to games and it's men playing, well, then naturally it leads to, you know, that just
retains that status
quo. And you need role models. I mean, again, back to the sport I cover, I mean, it's the infancy of the National League is even only in its infancy, you know. So there's a long, long way to go to get anything going, but there are steps being made. But then again, you look at other sports like racing, I'd be big into that, and you watch Punchestown this week, and you watch the role of sort of women in that industry, and they're not women in that industry, they're just people that are working in it, you know, as equals.
I want to get through a few texts before we wrap up. Brian in Dublin says, this is a really good point actually, first thing to do, guys, is to be clear what your objective is. Grow the sport, if so, what does that mean? Have a competitive league? I think the point there is what the GA were obviously trying to do with that think tank that they had about 2034 is, well, what do we actually want here? And I guess with football, you know, you kind of wonder, is it make the rich richer and, you know, make those the top of the
field? Who are you servicing? Are you servicing the TV viewer? Are you servicing the people on the ground running clubs? And because that's the thing, there's a lot is for the TV viewer, and even in England, like the spectator that goes to games there, and the working class roots of football, they're being priced out of games in some places. So, but people say, well, does that matter? Because consumers in around the world, they want more elite clashes, you know. So that's, I mean, it's a conundrum. There's no quick fix answer here, you know.
Final thoughts, gentlemen. Then Meath to beat Abu Dhabi
Southern Province
Sarsfields 2045 All Ireland, backed by their billionaire American owner.
I think it's until, well, you know what, I don't think it'll ever be broken. I don't think the corporate side of it, you know, and I know there's certain journalists who would just be banging on about this, especially in the GAA circles, that the corporate side of it has to be wrestled by. It's not going to be. It's just going to get bigger and bigger and bigger, because, you know what I mean, lots of companies are looking at it and saying, these are ways we can get out there. So media, advertising, etc., etc. But if it is left unchecked, it can get quite scary, especially in a relatively small sport such as the GAA. And it needs to be that the club game, that they need to be able to flourish both in tandem. And whatever how you do that, there is a way. Of course, when there's a will, there's a way. There's a way of doing it, disseminating the funds or whatever it is. But I think if it stays unchecked, you're only going to have a situation where the stronger are just going to get absolutely, unbelievably strong, and the rest will wither away.
And finally from you, Hugo, the point for rugby is that with professionalism, it's more likely to be the soccer situation, I guess, that the question, who are you serving, who are you servicing, or what are your aim is going to be harder to answer. It's going to be those who are paying for it.
Well, this is the traditional, the great thing about rugby, it's a traditional audience who've always watched it, but what's happened in recent years is it's just expanded so hugely. People who never usually watch rugby now watching, you know, it started with Munster, gone on to Ireland, now Leinster as well, and I think that's fantastic.
Yeah. Chaps, we'll have to leave it there. It was thoroughly enjoyable getting your thoughts into your crystal balls. Just to give you the score at Anfield, it's Liverpool 0, Stoke 0, 76 minutes gone there. After the break, we'll be building up to the 3 o'clock kickoffs in the Premier League. Keep your texts coming to 53106 and tweets to @OffTheBall.
The Saturday panel on Off The Ball.
In association with the Air Sport app. Allowing you to cast your favourite sporting action from your tablet or mobile phone straight to your TV.
Join the conversation at newstalk.com.
You thought your home was welcoming.